IVM.
So welcome to another week on IVM. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. This week on Simplified, in a shorty, Naren and Shrikat simplify the phenomena of near-death experiences with interesting cases and scientific theories. On Pragati, Pawan and Hamsini are joined by economic policy expert Yazad Jal to discuss negative and positive rights. On The Seen and the Unseen, Amit Verma is joined by stand-up comedian Aditi Mittal and our production controller Swati to discuss misogyny and popular culture. On Puliyabazi, Saurabh and Pranay speak to Shruti Rajgopalan about the meaning and importance of property rights in India. This week on Shunya One, we have Suchita Salwan, founder and CEO of LBP, a local recommendations platform striving to discover all things new and old. On Hustle Science, Ranveer and Tejaswin speak to their buddy, tech entrepreneur and founder of Hello Inc., Angad Nadkarni, to understand his coding craze and a lot more about his stories. And now, onto your shows.
Born into a poor family of five kids, where his parents didn't want him to go to school, he ended up not only graduating, but becoming a PhD. He then went on to become one of the scientists in BARC, which is the Atomic Energy Research Center. But I think the most interesting part of my guest today is from being a villager to then working in as a government servant. He started a business fairly later in his life with just an investment of rupees 2 lakhs. But today, his company has reached a very, very different scale. It is publicly listed. It's worth over 3,000 crores. Maybe it's already higher as we speak every day. And he's actually transformed the life of millions of Indians with regards to their health by taking one disease, which is thyroid. And he became literally the king of thyroid in terms of helping people transform and bringing that name in everyday vocabulary. Normally, people didn't know about thyroid as much. I'm really excited to have none other than Dr. A. Velumani, the founder and CEO of Thyrocare, also one of my gurus and mentors who have been taking advice for a long time, ever since I started Goki. So it's a real pleasure to have you on the show, sir.
Thank you very much, Vishal. And I'm indeed very excited to get me learned for me also.
No, sir, I think it's been really amazing. I think your story is such an inspiration for a lot of people because you started off at a very, very different stage, right in a village, in not a very well-to-do family. So tell me, how was it in the early days in a village in South India? How was it growing up over there, and how did you transition from there to here?
No, it's not anything happened in a few weeks or a few months. I'm 59 years old. And
59 years young.
Young. And it was a village. Nothing you can do for where you were born and to whom you were born. And it was a village where nothing was connected by train, road,
this
nothing.
This is close to Coimbatore.
It is 28 kilometers away from city of Coimbatore. And I was eldest among five children. And my father's village and my mother's village were 10 kilometers apart. And for some reasons, my father couldn't continue in his village. So he had come to my mother's village. So my entire youth days were only with my mother's village. Five children. My father wasn't all that happy about my mother, so was not a great support to my mother. My mother didn't have father. My mother didn't have support of anyone, but she had five children.
Wow.
So that is where I think I have been telling, I have become a father of a family at an age of 10, because I found my mother all alone struggling, and I took those responsibilities pretty early. And the village was not having school. School was 3 kilometers away. So going to school was a fantasy. And my mother did support. My father was wondering how education can be our cup of tea. But I think my mother kept on persuading us to go to school. I must tell you, my mother had two buffaloes. Each buffalo was giving around 5 liters of milk.
And this we are talking about now almost, what, 50 years back. So this was...
Yeah, 1962.
1960s, wow.
60s. So two buffaloes...
It was a very different India at that point of time.
Yeah, if you look at it, those days even... Buses were not there many in Coimbatore district itself. Hmm. Forget about the village. So it was a very different one. Those days, anybody in my village wearing a chappal was said to be a rich man. And anybody wearing a full trouser is said to be a very rich man.
Wow.
So this is how that village was. So my mother had two buffaloes. Each of them gave 5 liters of milk. So 10 liters of milk. I distinctly remember each liter was sold for 1 rupee. So that makes daily 10 rupees and weekly 60 rupees, 70 rupees. And my mother will use that 70 rupees to buy all that is required for the family to survive for the week.
Wow.
So many ask me today a question, where did you learn your business management? Now, I haven't gone to Harvard or Stanford or Kellogg. I think my mother was the one who taught me how to meet the ends when it is too small.
Absolutely right.
And if you know how to manage with no resource, low resources, you can manage business any day.
Wow.
So that way I salute her for having completely put in everything best possible. See, you know one thing, she had never borrowed a single rupee from anyone.
Wow.
And then she saw us finishing school. Then we saw ourselves that we are finishing the colleges. And we all finished graduations. We were the first in the entire village to do a graduation and entire family was graduated. Not only that, we three of us were together in Mumbai University doing post-graduation also.
Wow.
So if you look at it, it was a huge transformation from a small village. And it's a long journey.
It is said, right, that the mother is really the center of the universe. And I think it's really true in your case. And you know that...
I think I've been telling nowadays, if a man succeeds, a family prospers. If a lady succeeds, the society prospers. So my mother was a successful lady by bringing up the children. And today, if I'm an entrepreneur impacting Indian healthcare scenario, I think that was all well nurtured by her.
And was there something about South India in general where education is more important? Because in North India, people don't end up learning as much. They go to the farms, etc. So was there something about how did she give so much importance to education so early in 1960s, 1970s?
I think there were only two options for a man. Either you work in the field in the hot sun for lifelong and remain uneducated and do that. Or you become educated and sit in an office under a fan, under an AC and do the office work. So every mother would love to see their children not struggling in the hot sun. So that was the drive by my mother.
Wow.
But my drive was entirely different. I found in the entire village, all graduates had fair-looking wives.
Oh.
So I thought, why not me too? So that pushed me towards getting into a graduation.
Wow, that is a great motivation for getting into graduation. So you finished your school up to what, 10th grade?
Those days it was 11 plus 1 plus 3.
Okay.
So I was 11 and then went for a pre-university course and then did a BSc in chemistry, maths and physics.
And from Coimbatore, why did you decide to come to Mumbai and not Chennai? Because a lot of people from there end up going into Chennai.
It's not that in life where you want to go, you reach. Wherever you have reached, you never dreamt that you will be there.
Exactly.
Having said that, it was, fortunately, I am from a village. Fortunately, I am from a poor family. And fortunately, no one gave me a job in Coimbatore.
Fortunately. Wow.
And fortunately, the one who gave me a job, one company, that also was closed down.
Okay.
And then I had been applying for jobs across the country. Using one newspaper, that was Times of India, Wednesdays, there used to be a lot of situations.
Wednesday is the day.
This newspaper used to come to Coimbatore, and I used to sit in the library every
and
Wednesday.
Cut the ads, literally, right?
Every Wednesday, post 10 postcards. Because that was the only thing which I could afford to. I think if somebody persuades, things work.
Exactly.
And around 20 weeks, I might have been posting, and one fine day, I got an interview letter from Baba Atomic Research Center. Then I thought, let me romance with Mumbai and see by any chance my life
and
would
that
be
time
different.
You were already a graduate.
I was a BSc. Post BSc, 4 years of underemployment. So I was 24 years of age when I got an opportunity to come to Mumbai.
Wow. And BSc was done in Coimbatore?
Sir. Yeah, BSc was done in an institute called as Sri Ramakrishna Mission Vidyalaya. Mm-hmm. And my entire degree costed me only 1,000 rupees.
Entire degree?
Yes.
Wow.
And I got myself admitted or joined in a Harijan welfare hostel.
Okay.
Because that is where you get food and shelter free. Mm-hmm. And for me, getting a degree was anyhow a must. So I did all those things. In fact, how a boy of that background could have become a graduation itself is a 500 pages book.
Wow.
How many part-time jobs I did to pay to my schools and colleges, everything is very vivid in my memory.
Wow.
So then I get an interview later. So boarded in a Jayanti Jayanti Express. It starts from Kanyakumari, reaches Mumbai via Coimbatore.
Mm-hmm.
And 35 hours of journey, 25 hours I must have cried.
Cried?
Yeah, you can't leave your siblings and parents from, you know, the typical Tamil Nadu culture. You know, culture of Tamil Nadu is highly imbibed. Mm-hmm. Every district there is a culture, every taluk there is a culture.
Mm-hmm.
So I wasn't prepared to leave. But then I left. So in the train, I kept on crying and landed in VT railway station on August 18, 1982.
Wow. You and remember then, the date time.
Yeah,
huh? Wow.
And then 18, 19, 23 nights, I slept in VT railway platform.
Why is that?
Well, you didn't have friend to receive with a smartphone to take to their home. Nor I had a credit card to check in a hotel. Nor I had a purse to keep a credit card.
Wow.
There was only a 500 rupees in my pocket. And I have to get my first salary. Until that time, that 500 is my only amanat.
And you had to go for the interview.
Yes, I had to go for the interview and BRC.
And you said that let me stay at the station itself.
In
the wait, it was a waiting room.
It was not even a waiting room. It was just a platform.
Wow. 1982.
Yeah, I want to tell here, success in life is delta. Delta is equal to X2 minus X1. X2 is where you are today. X1 was where you were that day.
Wow.
And if X1 was zero, you have nothing to lose.
Exactly.
You ask me that village, poverty, that means for my life, my X1 was zero. And for my Bombay journey, X1 was zero.
Exactly.
And when X1 is zero, you have nothing to lose. When you have nothing to lose, you have the highest courage.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you know, today the problem is that people are like, oh, you know, I don't have the hotel booked. I don't have this. I don't have that. And people come up with all kinds of excuses to not do something. And look at this, you know, your story where you had like your delta was zero. So for that, nothing really mattered.
I think the big problem for today's generations are, they are unfortunately not poor.
Okay, that's a good
because,
way of looking at
because
it.
Because I was fortunate to be poor. Here they have been pampered. I use the word pampered because today's parents have probably felt pampering is the only way to bring up the children. And they can't travel without AC. They can't travel without reservations. They can't travel. Oh, for the first salary of 10,000, they come by air.
Exactly.
Right? That itself says there is a social pressure to work, not an intestine-driven pressure.
That's a good way to think about it. Not an intestine-driven pressure. Yeah, they are not hungry in the belly. There's no hunger in the belly, right? That's what they are talking about, right? They're already satisfied. And so coming back to it, right? So was Mumbai that time really the land of opportunities for India? Is it also
no,
that
no,
thought
no.
process?
I'll tell you, all Tamilians, destination is either Atlanta or Singapore because they don't have to face Hindi.
Ah.
Now, for me, it was not a planned trip to come to Mumbai. I got an interview and I thought, let me go and look at it. If everything is all right, continue to work there. If things are not all right, come back and do
because,
what
Because, yeah,
want.
That was the other thing. India was very, you know, divided. The South India was
no
Hindi at all.
So the South Indians hardly come to North. But if you ask, there were plenty of South Indians in Mumbai, even from 60s and 70s. But then love-hate of Madrasi was always a challenge for a good number of people. But I came here thinking that if I sit in a corner and look for my livelihood, no one will bother.
Mm-hmm.
So wow. I came to Mumbai just for livelihood. I never knew that something in store for me.
And during growing up, you know, that was the MGR era, right? That is when MGR was there in Tamil Nadu.
MGR was there till 1984. That means until I became 24 years of age, yeah, so, MGR was around. But I think a lot of influence of Tamilians has been from movies.
Yeah.
And if I look at the South Indian movies, they are largely around, you know, brother, sister, father, mother, daughter, son. These are the things which around which the movies are made. So I would call there's more emotions in South, more of dacoity, triangular love and loot, everything is in the North movies.
Yeah.
So if you look at it, the culture itself, South-North was very different, even from the movies point
exactly.
of view.
That's a very interesting way of looking at it. Right?
Movies have influenced a lot in Tamil Nadu because every hero, at least on the screen, was trying to be a good boy.
Mm-hmm.
So that gives a feeling and a definition of what is a good boy.
Oh.
There will be a bad boy villain. He is made as a bad boy even in the eyes of all people. So much so in some of the movies when the villain comes, there used to be some patthar thrown on the screen. To that extent, people were emotionally made to understand villain is villain.
Which is why, you know, I mean, like sitting in the North or in Mumbai, it's very difficult to understand the love of South India with their movie stars like gods, and Rajinikanth is like God, and
that's,
you know,
right.
There are people who are like making statues and temples. So it is that huge an influence.
I think in North, leaders are different. The movie stars are different. In South, the movie stars are leaders.
Mm.
I think this is almost some now 40 years. It was started by even Karunanidhi. Karunanidhi also had a movie background, though he was not a hero.
Hmm.
And then MGR took over from there. Then Jayalalitha took over from there. Then alternatively, all these guys. Then even in Andhra Pradesh, there was an NTR who was a chief minister for a pretty long period.
Exactly.
So if you look at it,
and now both Kamala Hassan and Rajinikanth
are also into politics.
Hmm, that's going to be quite... So... Clearly, you had the influence of the Tamil cinema where, you know, the hero is doing a good thing and you somehow felt that, you know, I'm being the good son by going and now getting this job. Is that?
Yeah, I think the family values were very much driven into the brain.
And what was the biggest cultural shock you got when you came to Mumbai, you know, coming from a
small
town?
For me, fortunately, there is no cultural shock because even in South, I was quite neutral to South Indian cultures. You know, let it be marriages, this and that. I had less belief and faith. So as soon as I came here, I was quite okay to get adopted to.
Mm-hmm.
What shocked me when I came to Mumbai by after buying a good pair of leather shoes,
mm-hmm,
and a suitcase, and came in the August month.
Oh, rainy
where
season.
Where it was pouring like anything. Without an umbrella, I landed in VT railway platform.
And it must be also flooding that place.
In Coimbatore,
right?
It rarely rains.
Yeah.
There is no season. Yeah. So I was caught, in fact, the monsoon is something which is very unique to Mumbai.
Exactly.
I enjoy it a lot.
I enjoy it
But
too,
in
yeah.
initial days, it was a bit tough to imagine this much rain, how a man can manage.
Exactly. So living in VT station for 3 days, so, you know, what were the thoughts? I mean, were you like sure on what you, because BRC is really far, right? So I live in Chembur and
yeah.
BRC is literally the other end. And that time in the 80s must be like, you know, you're going to a different city almost, right? When you were coming.
I'll tell you, many people in the train wanted to talk to me because I was keep on crying. So some South Indian family members were there and they asked me, where you want to get down? I was educated not to talk to anyone because anyone will be misguiding. So I didn't answer at all. They asked me, Kalyan, Dadar, VT, I don't know where is what.
Okay.
One thing I clearly knew, last station I'll get down.
Yeah.
And VT railway station was the last station. Not that by any intelligence, it was just by
last station.
Then I understood BRC is far away.
Exactly.
Had I got down in Dadar, it would have been closer.
Yeah.
Then I take a train and go to Vikhroli.
Okay.
And in Vikhroli, I took a bus. And the bus those days was, that particular day was not moving at all.
Ah.
And I reached the interview by 4 hours late.
Four hours? I thought,
now my job is all gone.
This is Anushakti Nagar.
But it looks like that day, many could not come and I came. Look at the nature. I went there thinking that I lost the interview
because of the rains.
Finally, I got the chance because many didn't turn up.
Wow, this is the rains and all of that.
And very important here, is, in the interview I was asked a question, where is thyroid? Mind you, I was a maths, physics, chemistry student.
They asked you in the BARC
interview. In the interview. I said, I don't know. And the most important point is, in 1982, I did not know where is thyroid.
And now you're
in 1992, I had finished my PhD in thyroid biochemistry. And in 2002, I'm running world's largest thyroid testing laboratory.
I think this deserves a...
The punchline is... The punchline is, if you do what you have studied, you will survive. If you do what you have studied, you will survive. And if you do what you have not studied, you will be the leader.
Oh.
So I keep motivating youngsters, moka mela to reset karo.
Exactly. I mean, this is quite a story, right?
Yeah.
So you gave this interview in 1982.
Yes.
And BARC was like a big deal, right? That time it was the most premier institute.
Even today, any postgraduate in science and technology, or postgraduate PhD.
And it's a government job.
Government jobs. Most fantasy for any scientist.
So my father's elder brother, he's also retired, of course, as a scientist in BARC. So I know that getting into BARC is very tough.
Getting out also is very tough.
Because they give you this amazing, that Anushakti Nagar is like paradise.
You know the right word, they opiate you.
Oh, opiate with the good air and good air and schools.
Absolutely. You just can't come out of
Anushakti Nagar. Yeah,
anesthetized.
Yeah. Exactly. So you worked with BRC in which division was this?
It is known as Radiation Medicine Center. And it was a medical division. And
so there's a BRC hospital also right?
Yeah. But my unit was in Tata Memorial Hospital, Parel. Where it was, how cancer can be cured using radioisotope. In that division, there was a connection between thyroid and radioactivity. That is how I got into BRC and then got thyroid connected. It is all never planned.
Yeah, exactly. And then you said you ended up doing your PhD while at BRC.
Yes. BRC is an institute which allows you to do research. So you do your research, submit your thesis. If it is good, you get degrees. That's a bonus. When I came to Mumbai, I thought my studies, there is a full stop. Now it is a comma, and still now it is a comma. I can keep studying.
Absolutely. And at what point of time did you then finally get married? This is when you were in Mumbai, or you got married in...
No, I came to Mumbai at an age of 24. And for me, marrying in Mumbai was... something didn't gel with me because I found the Bombay girls' accent in English, their dressing sense, and I myself was feeling too small in my own organization where all local Mumbai girls were there. So I was totally against. But then my father-in-law found me somewhere, and then he was in intense love with me.
Your father-in-law.
Any man who has a marriageable age daughter has to love a boy.
Yeah.
So that the daughter finds happy tomorrow. So he was persuading me. And I thought, let me have a look at the girl and then refuse rather than refusing blindly.
And how did you end up meeting them in BRC? No,
my father-in-law was a security officer in BRC.
Ah.
So he had keeping an eye on all South Indian boys going in and going out. He had three daughters marriageable age.
Yes, so he's like, okay, this guy is coming on time to office,
yes,
doing everything.
Yeah. And then go to personal department, you can see the full kundali.
Yeah.
So he did intelligent research.
Wow.
So then I thought I will have a look at her and then take a call. When I had a look at her, she was not impressive at all. Then I thought, once you go back and keep silent, they will understand it. But then my father-in-law was persuading again. And I thought this gentleman should be now told it's not going to work out. Mm-hmm. But then when I sat in front of him, the innocent face didn't allow me to tell it bluntly on his face. So and I thought I will ask him. An opportunity to meet the girl for an hour where I will tell the girl, discourage the girl so that the girl tells the father, I don't want to marry this boy.
That was a great idea from a Tamil movie, I'm sure.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is something happened in Nariman Point in Madam Kama Road in the State Bank of India. My wife was working in State Bank of India in the 14th floor. I went there. For 1 hour, we talked. And in 1 hour, there are 60 minutes. 55 minutes, I only talked. And 5 minutes, absolute silence was there.
Okay.
She was only looking at me. She was not at all talking anything. Didn't ask a single question.
And you're like,
then I thought I must marry this girl. If a girl doesn't speak for one full hour, that too in front of a boy whom she is going to get married.
This is the perfect combination.
This is the perfect combination. And in that 1 hour, I kept on telling her what I don't have. Mm. Even whatever I had, I told I don't have. So much so, I told her, look, for our marriage, if it goes through, you have to spend. The next point is, if you are spending, your father should not know it.
Okay.
Can you imagine all this kind of conditions put? Then I told her, if you still want to marry me, tell your father to meet me tonight. Otherwise, tell him something is wrong with the boy.
So you had this whole script prepared.
Oh, God.
Full script.
I must tell you one thing. I had removed all expectations and my life subsequently was most pleasant.
Ooh.
Because I told you I don't have
anything.
So everything I declared, in fact, this is the best possible strategy someone if they want to live a happy married life.
Okay.
Otherwise, normally what
rather,
people do?
Oh, I have this, I have that.
Are, mera chacha ye hai, mera papa ka sister ye hai. Everything they will tell, unfortunately, raising all expectations. Let me tell you the punchline here. Resignations or divorces happen only because an unwanted expectations.
Ooh.
So if you can keep for both cases low, they will
everything
be
is a bonus. Delta, your delta
everything
formula.
Everything is a bonus. But I want to tell you here, I asked my wife after 3 months of marriage, what was that which made you to marry me, in spite of me telling all such things? She said, in a short family, being a tall daughter-in-law makes a lot of sense than being a short daughter in a tall family.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a very powerful way of her interpretation. And many would, you know, marriage is two kinds. Marriage is two kinds. One is like debt, another is like equity.
Hmm.
Everybody matches two bedroom, that is known as debt, safety, security. My wife married a boy from village and she took equity.
Ooh, that's another very,
very, very important one.
And what was your family's reaction? So you finally saw your father-in-law met you in the evening. So did your family also...
My family was not involved in this process because I believe in life either you can discuss or decide, you can't do both.
Okay.
So I didn't discuss. And I became a head of the family at an age of 10.
Mm.
So no one is going to ask me why, because no one asks me why. Today I am very powerful because from the age of 10, no one asked me why.
You were the
head of the family.
You were the CEO.
So I just thought I will decide everything. Finally, I told my mother. And my mother was a bit concerned because I was the eldest son. Eldest daughter-in-law is very important in Hindu families to nurture the rest of the family. My mother was worried might be my son will no more be what he was. I think my wife ensured I am better son than what I was.
Wow. And you kept going back to Tamil Nadu and getting them, or they were still in Coimbatore?
No, I brought the entire family to Bombay.
Oh.
My second brother is a lawyer. He studied in Mumbai University, LLM. And he is a CFO today.
Oh, wow.
He is still with my business and he is also co-promoter.
Mm-hmm.
And another brother also with me, a part of this business till recently. My sister also was in Mumbai.
Mm-hmm.
So in that way, you know, you have only two options. Either you go back home or get the home to Mumbai.
Exactly.
I brought the home to Mumbai. But then finally all of them have settled in Coimbatore.
Mm-hmm.
I and my children only are in Mumbai.
Got it. So this was again, I would say, early 90s is when all this
My marriage was 1986 and I was a government officer till 1996. So 10 years.
Wow.
The Vishal Gondal Show will be right back after this break.
Shunya one. $1 billion acquisition. Another copycat startup got formed.
No, the tech world in India is surely moving double the speed of this voiceover.
Tune in to Shunya One every Tuesday to catch us talking to the smartest people we know on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcasts from.
And, you know, like, I have not heard of people leaving BRC. It's one place you only live when you retire. You know, that's how typically it is. But for you, you decided to quit that organization for not joining another big company, but for starting your own company. So how did that happen? And that was a very, very bold decision, given that you had all the security in the world with everything there. So what happened? What made you take that decision?
I think I have been telling either you can discuss or you can decide. You can't do both. I came to Mumbai without discussing with my father. And I got married without discussing with my mother. And I resigned my job without discussing with my wife. I went to office in the early morning. And the entire morning I worked. I had lunch. Then during around 4 o'clock, opened the drawer. And I found my closing balance in the passbook was 2 lakh rupees. I'm talking about 1995, when 2 lakh was equivalent to today's 1 crore. And then I looked at what is my family expenditure. It was roughly around 5,000. So 2 lakh divided by 5,000, 40 months my family is safe. So tick number one. Tick number two, I was searching. Right side there was a colleague with 2-bedroom hall kitchen. Left side another colleague with 3-bedroom hall kitchen. Both of them had 20 years of EMI. I was the only guy without EMI. Tick number two. The third one, my wife is working in State Bank of India. Tick number three, I took the yellow paper and resigned and went home. I didn't ask anyone. My boss was shocked. Every colleague was shocked. Tumhara kya ho gaya suddenly? I was the happiest employee. There was nothing wrong with the job, nothing wrong with my, nothing. But I resigned and went home.
And this was at the age of what, 35?
1995, I was 37. My son was 7. My daughter was 5.
Wow.
And then in the dinner table, I didn't tell anything. And night 2 o'clock, my wife asked me a question. Aaj aap soya nahi hai. Then I said, I have resigned. Until that time, she was horizontal. And then she became vertical. And she looked at me for a few seconds. Then she said, if you don't go to office from tomorrow, if you don't go to office from tomorrow, even I will not go.
Ooh.
So that was a dhamki which came in the middle
major
of the night.
Major dhamki, huh?
Oh, yes. That is what happens if you discuss. At night, 2 o'clock, my wife wanted me to reverse my decision. Until that time, I was horizontal. Then I became vertical. And I said, chalo, saath jiyenge, saath marenge. Mind you, both of us did not go to office from that day.
She also resigned.
She also did not go. Now, two people, State Bank of India job, Baba Atomic Research Center job, both of them gave up the job on the same day. And I want a message to be told. Please, romance with risk.
Romance with risk.
And if the risk is substantial, the outcome is going to be
beautiful.
Very beautiful.
Absolutely.
So, today I made a history. Today I stand and tell stories all because I didn't go to office because my wife said I will resign. I only told her, you also resign. Let us together do and succeed.
Amazing. And I think, you know, that. So one of my favorite topics is to tell people that the biggest risk is not taking a risk.
Risk, not because, deciding.
Exactly. And I think in your case, it was not just a risk, it was a double risk.
Right? I must tell you, I'm a thrill monger. From that village, I could have been there. I came to Mumbai because a thrill was needed. And then I married a Bombay girl because I was looking for a thrill.
But she was also from Coimbatore or no?
She is from Tamil Nadu, Tanjavur. So made a, you know, what you call as thrill monger. Then I left a government job. Then
you know, I can already see a movie coming up very soon. I won't be surprised if there is a movie being made on this. There is so much thrill in this, right?
If somebody sees a story there and power there.
There is one Coimbatore resident, Murugan, on whom Padman is made. So now we need to have the blood man.
Lab man.
Yeah, the next movie. Yeah, we should give this idea to Akshay Kumar.
Jisko dena hai, de do.
Yeah. So then you said that, so you both decided and you quit your job on the same day. And what did you do the next week, the next month? How did this idea of Thyrocare came about?
See, it is because I was posted in a job of testing thyroid. So on the table on the shelf everywhere thyroid.
So quickly, what is thyroid? A lot of people even now don't understand.
Yeah, thyroid is a 15 gram gland in the neck where the tie knot sits. This 15 gram gland produces two hormones. And this hormone drives your body like how coal drives a train.
So that's the metabolism. Literally.
Metabolism. Without this hormone, there won't be a metabolism.
And what is the hormone called?
T3, T4. These hormones convert mass into energy. And if you don't have this hormone, you will only be a mass, you won't have energy. And if the hormones are too much, you won't have a mass, it will all become energy. Very, very katarnak.
So that's when they say that hypothyroid makes you fat and, you know, hyper will...
This is a very important gland in the body. In other words, people now say, this man has focused on thyroid so much, it now thyroid looks like Android.
Android is everywhere, huh? And I think especially for women, I mean, thyroid is the biggest problem, right? More than men?
I must tell you, one out of five are only men. Remaining four are women. So when we look at it, it is 4:1. Women in the reproductive age are more vulnerable to thyroid problems.
So you were already testing thyroid.
And I was testing in a government laboratory where there is no way of making money. You have to morning to evening, you need to do the test. And I found this thyroid testing has been wrongly priced in the market. You know one thing, wherever you see something is unnecessarily priced high, you can find a business there.
So what was the kind of pricing for this?
500 rupees for thyroid testing in 1995 when dollar was only 15 rupees.
Wow. So that's like paying 5,000.
Literally.
Wow.
So I came into picture and I told 100 rupees it can be done. And that was a shock to everyone. That pricing was so disruptive. People wanted me to believe that I'm madman. Everybody told you're a crazy man, it will not succeed. Ye madrasi vapas nanga bagega. And let me tell you, if everybody tells you are wrong,
then
you
are
means
you are
right.
You're right.
So don't have to worry about anybody telling you wrong. Exactly. So I kept the lowest rate. It impacted a lot.
No, but then you went and bought the machinery. I mean, how did you start the company?
And let me tell you, this was something equivalent to how Mahatma Gandhi did a sarka. A machine which was worth only 50,000. I purchased that. I did the business. Money came. I bought one more machine. Did the business. Bought two more machines. Bought eight more machines. Bought 16 more machines. Today I have got in my floor 1,000 machines. Business doesn't need money. Business needs stamina.
You had the stamina to keep doing this?
Yes, I keep telling people in Mumbai, people with money cannot make money, but people with stamina can make a hell of money. So it wasn't needing money. See, kon syringe kholta hai, purse kholne se pehle. Have you noticed it? First, patient opens the purse. Then only you open the syringe. The money has to come from the market. Why it has to come from somewhere else?
That's a very good way of looking at it.
So, in fact, today I run a company with negative working capital.
Yeah.
So, that is something which no one can imagine. Such a low rate. No, what you call as a debt in the market. You don't give credit to anyone. Oh, dream business.
Exactly. Exactly. And people are really, this is a necessity, right?
That's my luck is, once thyroid patient, he is lifelong thyroid patient. So every year, once or twice, they have to come to get it titrated. So I have got a great loyal following up for my business.
So how did you convince the first set of people to sell you the machinery? Because I presume these machines were made by Siemens and all these.
No, those days it was some local company, ECIL, was making a small machine. Today, it is like, we have evolved from fully manual to fully automatic in 20 years. And first 4 years, it was fully manual. Then only the multinationals come inside. And then 4 years, I had enough cash.
Okay.
Within 6 months, I got viability. Today, many people ask me, Dr. Velumani, your initial days would have been very difficult. Who funded it? No one funded. I was frugal.
And no banks were giving loans and nothing.
I didn't go for any equity dilution, nothing. Roj paisa aata hai businessman.
And where did you set up your first center?
It is in Baikala, opposite to Rani Bagh.
There was a hospital there?
Yeah, that side is hospital, but I found it very close to Baikala station. So I took a 275 square feet garage and rented garage for rupees 5,000 rent. Mm-hmm. And I can never forget how my first 100 samples came, how my first 1,000 samples came.
And how did people discover this? I mean, how did people know that this is a place I could go to?
Oh, test? No one comes to me. I go and pick up the specimen.
Right. See, from this,
the entire business is not a conventional business. It's an unconventional business. You know one thing, everybody has a restaurant and a kitchen behind. Restaurant is engage the patient, collect the blood, and kitchen is to do the test. So this is a conventional model. My model is become a kitchen for every restaurant. So in Mumbai, if there are 1,000 laboratories, I go and tell them, gentlemen, you are buying the reagent. Reagent is 200 rupees. You give me 100 rupees. I do the test. Agar do bhi sasta hai, to koi washing mein se nahi kharidta.
Exactly.
So that is impactful business model. Then I found entire Mumbai is supporting me. Then I went to Pune, supported me. Nasik supported me. Surat supported me. Then I went to Hyderabad, Cochin and Coimbatore. Specimen started flying. It's done.
So just to kind of understand, so previously people had their own reagent and they were charging 500 rupees for a test. Now you said charge the same 500 rupees.
You don't have to buy 200 rupees reagent. You give me 100 rupees, I'll do the test and give you the result.
Got it. So that time you were literally like saying that I am actually saving money for you because
absolutely.
And saving the hassle.
If you outsource, you will get better quality at a cheaper rate.
But there was no Thyrocare brand at that time. People didn't know it was Thyrocare. Or...
No. The day I started, my brand is Thyrocare.
No, but did the consumers know it was from Thyrocare? Because if you were the kitchen...
First 10 years, I was pure B2B brand.
Okay. So no, the consumer never saw Thyrocare.
No. The reports were going of Thyrocare.
Ah, because you were printing it in...
Because that guy cannot tell he himself did the test. He has to tell me the test is done by someone who is qualified.
Ah.
I was a PhD in thyroid biochemistry, so my designation was my brand.
Are, wow, this is a good...
Yeah, it all has happened. I was in a right time, did right thing with the right spirit, and today I am said to be a very powerful man.
No, of course you are. So coming back, so you then got this whole B2B model working, where people went, paid them, and then... you could start testing. When did you decide to transition from this B2B to B2C model? That must be a different thing, right?
See, B2B was good, giving revenues. Everything was going on all right. But I somehow felt I need to do some more disruption. So I created an Arogyam as a package. Arogyam is not individual test. It is like a Complan, Bonvita, or a Horlicks. It's a package. Then I experimented and it worked. That time, Times of India wanted to invest in us. And I thought this big name is coming, why not I take money? I took a 5% dilution and took some money, 25 crores. And I put that money into full page advertisement nationwide in Times of India publications. People were wondering, how come this man advertises a laboratory test like Volkswagen and Mercedes? But then it became a very powerful Arogyam brand. So,
pro Arogyam now, yeah.
Thrill chahiye. Everything experiment. Don't sit comfortably thinking that it is working well, let me sleep. So this Arogyam itself was another experiment, which fortunately has worked. Today 40% of my revenue comes from Arogyam.
Fantastic.
And that's a B2C brand.
But the whole diagnostic industry which you are part of, so while you only focused on thyroid, that was the time when there were all these other labs coming up, Metropolis, SRL and all these who were trying to do all tests. So they were never trying to focus on one thing.
No, actually everyone was interested in a grocery. I was the guy who was interested in a cake shop.
Okay.
So that way mine was focused on disorders, focused on thyroid, focused on metabolism, focused on patients who are at home and office, not at clinic and hospital. So mine was bit of unique experiment which fortunately succeeded. So if you look at it, if there are 100,000 laboratories, 999,000 are in a different kind of mode, and I am in a very different kind of mode.
Which is why the pricing, the entire system is very different in the case of Thyrocare.
I must tell you, I have done a McDonald's, which means focus on burger, take it global. I focused on thyroid, took it national. If you do everything, you can't go national.
Exactly. You then have to become regional.
Regional and local.
Wow. And how did you create a team? I know, you know, you speak a lot about team hiring and, you know, because, you know, you can't do this on your own. You need more people around you and kind of build an organization. So how did you go around doing that?
Yeah, Vishal, you asked me a very emotional question. Let me tell you, in 1978, when I finished my degree, I went and gave interviews in Coimbatore. My degree was done in May, and in June month, they're asking, do you have experience? And 50 interviews I have been rejected because I didn't have experience. If someone gives you a job, then only you can get an experience.
Exactly.
So that time itself, very emotionally, I took a decision. One day, if I have a company, I will not take experienced. I will take only freshers. Mind you, today I have 1,200 employees. For all of them, I'm the first employer.
Wow. By design?
By design. I don't interview experienced. I only interview freshers. In fact, in my company, if somebody has to come and say, there are three criteria. One, he should be fresher. Second, he should be from a village. Third, he should not speak good English.
Wow.
You must be wondering, why is that good English you don't like? The one who knows good English jump very often to other jobs. The guy who doesn't know English will sit and work. My simple philosophy has worked.
Absolutely. It has not only worked, it has succeeded,
succeeded
massively.
Succeeded. So I'm a good storyteller. So I must have told good story to the first five employees. Probably the story also was good. It became 50 employees. Then I continued to tell stories. It becomes 500 employees. Now we are in the process of reaching to 5,000 employees. I think a good storytelling is very important to make an employee to dream a long run with you.
No, but more than storytelling, it is also then delivering the promise.
Obviously, right? Yeah. If you tell story which you don't follow, the next year people will leave. But there is a huge correlation between what you do and what you talk. If the both of them are, you know, we believe in trust, truth and transparency. These three are there, the organization continues to grow.
And, you know, you were then competing with all these people with MBAs in Harvard, you know, all these other companies, CEOs have, you know, studied in all these foreign institutions. So how did you kind of deal? Did you ever felt that, no, maybe I should have had different team or different kind of people? Did you ever have that urge?
No, I think with all said and done, I had no true trust on MBA empowering you to do better business. It gets you to understand more vocabulary, more business models, how they have failed or succeeded. But the ground performance of a man is very different from the education. My boys can focus and can do any job if I train them. So criteria of my top management, my vice president today, who has finished 18 years of service, started his first day only with me.
Wow.
So in that way, I have created own resources. I have not got enamored by somebody who is throwing a big CV. And I will continue to do that because I am good at rearing my own team.
Amazing. Amazing. That's a very, very interesting perspective, because this is not how typically when people talk about hiring, they're like, we're going to hire from
IIT. I was
IIT,
not in a hurry to grow. I was not in a hurry to make a presentation pitch to any of the investors. And I knew this company I'm going to run lifelong. If you are creating a company to sell someone, you will hire anyone. If you are going to run this company for your life, you will have patience and choose the guy who is performing, not the guy who is claiming to be performing.
That's a very, very interesting perspective to look at. And so are you saying that every year was a great year for Thyrocare? You never had a challenge as a company?
I think
the scaling is a very different challenge, right? I mean, starting up with 5, 10, 50 machinery versus scaling to 5,000 is a very different challenge.
I think recently I read it somewhere in social media. If your business model is good, you don't need a model to sell it. Which says the business model itself is the most powerful vehicle. I have done this business for 20 plus years. I think my CAGR has been 25% for the last 20 years.
Wow.
if at all something has gone down to 16%, 17%, the next year it got compensated by 30% and 28%. So these ups and downs are always there. We don't know what is the reason, but up and downs are always there. Some competition comes, they become aggressive, then they don't truly succeed, then again our turnover grows well. But if you ask me, not a single day in business or in life I had a dull moment or a worrying moment.
Wow.
59 years, it has always been up and up and up only. There was never ups and downs.
And I think it all started with your delta formula.
Exactly.
Right?
When you start from zero and you don't have unnecessary expectation, things work.
Exactly. That's an amazing, I mean, you know, I think people need to think about this delta very, very strongly, because people are just depressed today. There's depression, there's all kinds of challenges.
All because of there are some wrong parenting happening. Nowadays, I run a program in South. The program name is Art of Parenting.
Oh.
And there I go and tell what my mother did not do for me. Everybody will tell what the parents did. And I tell them I'm a very successful man only because my parents did not do anything to me.
Mm.
They left me. They left me free. They made me to take all decisions. I become powerful.
Mm.
What you guys in this era, mothers are doing, not allowing the child to take any decision.
Exactly. I'm going to decide for
Absolutely.
You.
Absolutely. They think the child cannot take decision. In business or in life.
Or they are not as smart to take decisions.
In business or in life, there are a few mistakes. Please do them fast and learn from them. Don't repeat them.
Exactly. So what is your benchmark for hiring people? Or how do you decide whether you're going to trust somebody or not trust somebody?
No. One thing, if you ask me, Vishal, all my employees I have taken only at a 2 lakh per annum CTC. That is at the base level.
The base level.
The one becomes, one who is intelligent reaches 10 lakhs within 3 years. The other guy becomes 10 lakhs in 10 years. That is their own capabilities. All resources are raised internally. We just don't. Interview itself is not a right procedure. In 10 minutes, 15 minutes in an interview, what you can assess about an individual.
No, but if you have a job and 5,000 people apply for a post of 400 people or 550 people, how do you filter that?
Aisa situation abhi tak aaya nahi
hai.
In India, not getting enough candidate is the biggest concern for CEOs. So in our organization, daily some 20 guys walk in. 10 guys our people will shortlist. While shortlisting, as I said, poor village and
no English.
Less English is the criteria.
Amazing. This is like completely redefining the rules of business, right? I mean, all the people, and I'm sure some of your competitors are going to start listening to this podcast and they will be like, oh man.
They know what is already happening. All my competitors have 5% of employees from my floor.
Ooh.
I don't have a single employee of my competition in my floor. They are aware of it.
When you are the innovator, you are the leader, this is what happens, right? Everybody
in that way, I have so far employed 7,000 people. 1,200 are with me. Remaining are in the industry, all over the country.
So you have become the school.
Yeah, in that way, if you look at it, in any industry, somebody who is leading provides resources needed for other players to build up.
So same thing happened in my last business in gaming, right? So the India Games, I think we had a few thousand or 1,500 people also go through our company, and we became the university literally. Mm. So you couldn't find another company where there was not a single ex-India Games employee. So I think it's the same
it's
case
happening.
Today in the industry.
It's happening.
No, talking a little bit more about the industry, there is a lot of malpractices people talk about in the diagnostic world of, you know, wrong testing. They also talk about this thing called the sink test, where you just give a blood and, you know, it is just poured in this sink. And then there are all these reports where the numbers are all varying. You know, how do you respond to stuff like this, right? And I'm sure this is not, you know, specific to your company or any other company. I think it's a problem of the industry itself.
No. I think I must tell you, 10% of the laboratories don't do any malpractice.
10%. 90%.
90% of them do some kind of malpractice. We can't call as malpractices.
90%.
Compromises.
90%.
See, India has 100,000 laboratories. So 10% itself is 10,000. you should be happy that 10,000 laboratories in the country are doing their quality work.
Something like this should be 100%. I mean, there should
be
some...
No, in that way, this industry was unorganized. Anybody who had even a lakh or two had started a laboratory. So this industry is as bad as any other industry.
No, but I'm saying when it deals with human life, I mean, you know, people based on your reports are going to be consuming medicine, deciding on procedures. There, if there is a huge, there's like 90%.
I won't blame the laboratories. I blame those doctors who patronize that laboratories. Because a doctor is the judge there. He is having the trust of the customer there. He shouldn't trade it. So doctor should know within no time, an intelligent doctor knows that this report is wrong. It is not correlating with the symptoms of the patient. Whereas country has that many unfair laboratories means I still blame the medical community for allowing them to survive and sustain.
We did a research early this year on the trust on Indian healthcare system. And 93% people do not trust the healthcare system. 93%.
Yeah, I'm almost agreeing with that.
It is such a sad state. But, you know, on the contrast, you know, the number one trusted person on healthcare ended up becoming Baba Ramdev. Number two person is Akshay Kumar. So I think clearly Bollywood and the whole, you know, our religious gurus have a bigger influence somehow in this country related to health than even the doctors. So what is your thoughts around all the Babas who are now becoming the health authorities in the country?
I think the entire understanding about health by all these so-called scientists, doctors has been very little. We felt we know everything. We know hardly anything. So today allopathy is unable to solve many problems except reducing some pains and intervening in some infections. Otherwise, nothing truly. Diabetes could not be cured. Arthritis could not be cured. Cancer could not be diagnosed. Cardiovascular diseases could not be predicted. So if you look at it, we are where we were.
Allopathy has made it worse, actually.
We can't tell it made it worse. It has given some solutions and it has given some problems also. So then people look back and tell, why not Ayurvedic? It is still good. Why not homeopathy? So all those things have got today an attention because allopathy is no more what it was claimed to be. So having said that, I think tomorrow is not going to be medicine. Tomorrow is going to be wellness, nutrition,
and
fitness.
Yeah.
These three, we went wrong. We should have focused on nutrition, which we didn't do.
Exactly.
We became slaves of tongue. Yeah. And today our health is gone.
And diabetes is a completely reversible condition, especially type 2 diabetes. And you have your own experience now.
So I think what had happened was carbohydrate consumption. Carbohydrates are good for tongue. So people started cultivating rice, wheat, sugar, potato, which is very dangerous. And we all started enjoying and became victims of carbohydrates. So this is a story for the last 500 years.
Now and people they said understand. Fat is bad.
Fat is bad was a wrong propaganda.
Exactly.
Cholesterol is cardiovascular risk itself is a wrong propaganda.
HDL is what you need and it's a good cholesterol.
So today the story is suddenly in the year 2000 onwards, fat is good. Carbohydrate is bad. So now you look at what kind of 100 years of harassment the human being has undergone because of the wrong preaching. So there has been challenges. There have been vested interests by pharmaceutical companies to sell their drugs.
And junk food companies were selling chips and sugar.
No, with all said and done, we became slaves of our tongues. And my punchline here, if you eat for your intestine, it is $2 per day. And if you eat for your tongue, it is $10 per day. And if you eat for your eyes, it is $20 per day. And if you eat for your nose, it is $40 per day plus 28% GST.
Wow. So why is the nose so expensive?
Because that crowd who doesn't have purse limit.
Oh, exactly. Yeah, Exactly.
You can, tomorrow onwards, get into a 5-star and you can understand what is happening.
Exactly. No, and now people are talking about even diets which are going back to the paleo diets and, you know, which was the olden times. Or, you know, people are wanting to eat ragi and jawar and millets. I mean, that's what India was all about.
Eat less, eat right, no disease.
Exactly.
Eat less
and
eat right.
And be active.
Be active. So we all became slaves of, you know, lazy man found out all solution which made his body to become bad. Punchline. Mm. What is good to tongue is bad to body.
Exactly.
So if something is good to your tongue, please avoid it.
Exactly. So again, in your case, it's literally the rags to riches story. Your company went public just a couple of years back. I mean, less than two years ago.
2.5 years.
2.5 years ago. It's today the market cap is hovering between 3,000 to 4,000 crores. You are yourself worth several thousand crores. So what is your, you know, how was that phase of your life where you finally listed, and why was listing important to you? Because if this was a private company, you could have kept it private. How is it different than a publicly listed company where you are answerable to public shareholders versus being a private
company?
All
thrill-monging. I was doing a good company. No debt. Everything was going on. Cash in the balance sheet. That time only investors came and asked me, why don't you give some stock to us?
Mm.
I didn't want to give. So I told the double number. They still persuaded. Then I went to even 3X. They bought it. Now, I have diluted. Once you have diluted, some private equity is inside.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they have to go after 5 years out. I could have told them, you find another private equity and go out. But then once again, thrillmonger. I thought, let me get it listed.
Next level.
My mind was telling, if you don't get listed, Tamilians will not know Thyrocare is run by Velumani. So this was the thrill.
Wow.
And then I got it listed and the IPO went on wonderful. We got subscribed 75 times oversubscribed.
Yep. Yep.
30,000 crore was in my bank account on a particular day evening.
Ooh.
And then the entire country comes to know, acha, this is a Madrasi who is running this Thyrocare. And people from Tamil Nadu started calling, wow, that's a great success. Mind you, recently I was invited to Coimbatore with an award of Best Entrepreneur of the Year. So I got the award and they wanted me to talk for a few minutes and I kept the award on the table and told, thank you very much. Thank you for not giving me a job in 1982. Had you given me a job, I would have completely succumbed here itself.
Yes, and
you made me strong, powerful, successful. Thank you very much. So that was my
Coimbatore's loss was, yes, for a win for India.
Absolutely. So for me, it is a kind of, you know, in Tamil, there is a Bharatanatyam and there is an Arangetram.
Arangetram is like, okay, the
right
big performance.
So for anybody who runs a good company, getting listed in a national stock exchange is then Arangetram. So I have done it.
Wow.
And afterwards, I have become a powerful storyteller.
Mm.
Otherwise, who will listen to your story? Only when, more than anything else, had I not listed, who would know what is my market cap?
Exactly. Exactly.
So do it.
Exactly. No, and I think, you know, all your life, right, your decision to come to Mumbai, your decision, the way you got married, the way you quit your job, the way you started Thyrocare, I think everybody, every moment is like a big decision, right? This is going to be like things, I'm sure there are already case studies made out of this, which everybody is talking about.
I think the man who takes bold decision makes a very powerful journey. And the one who is worried about taking a decision is called KPM.
KPM.
Kaya Piya Margaya.
And there is one more, KPMG. And they hire people like that, right? All the consultants.
So in life, if you want to truly achieve something, you must be restless.
Absolutely.
You must be restless.
You know, there is this amazing word which I love, which is only the paranoid succeed. So there is a fear. There's a difference between fear and paranoid. You need to be paranoid. And in your case, you kept evolving. And even now on the digital side, right? I mean, I know Thyrocare. I mean, all the digital companies who have come up, they're all mostly largely using the Thyrocare kitchen, as
absolutely,
you say, right?
Absolutely. In the back end, we are the kitchen.
For almost everyone.
I think 70-80% of the startups have found this man is present nationally. This man has the lowest cost. This man got a very efficient system. So that is, in fact, a driver for growth.
No, absolutely.
Today.
Even we at Goki have partnered with you.
Yeah, in that way, you know, you name any company, it's there.
Wow. That's quite a story.
Yeah, so, today the growth is driven by these kind of companies which use my back-end kitchen.
Amazing. Now, coming back to, you know, you were talking about parenting as a big thing, and you do believe that parenting could have a very big difference to the future.
According to me, good children cannot create any impact. Only nuts can. That too.
How do you make your
children? That too. Nuts with guts. So make sure first guts are there and then he is a nut.
Yes.
Oh, it is very important. The good children have only become a bank officers.
Or MBAs or... Yeah.
So I always tell parents, look, don't chase for marks. Make them to think. Don't bring in fear. I remember once my father asked me, do you want to swim in the village? I said, where can I learn? He took me to a kuwa, well. And 45 steps, if I go down, there is water. Hmm. He told me, you get down step by step. After 5 steps, he kicked me inside water. Now, I struggled and then finally I come out and I was crying with my dad. Why was that kicking? He told, koi 10 minute tak marta nahi hai. No one dies for 10 minutes. That means what my father did, he didn't bring in fear. He brought in
confidence.
Courage.
So
that 10 minutes, no one will die. If you know it, you are not worried.
Yes. So and this is somebody there to help you in those 10 minutes.
More than anything else, my parents did not lay roads for their children. They made sure that their children can run in any road.
Any road. Ooh. Because today what parents are trying to do is lay path for you. Literally like guide you from point A to point B.
And mind you, philosophically, my parents saw the world through our eyes. Yes. They didn't force us to see the world through their eyes.
Amazing. That's a very, very powerful statement. So how have you used this philosophy with your own kids? I know I've met your son. He's super smart.
I think my success is because of two ladies. Mm-hmm. One was my mother. She is no more. And she had brought me up to 25. Made my intestines to withstand the all onslaughts and got me a degree and got me married. Hmm. The mantle was subsequently carried by my wife. Yeah. And we lived for 30 years. She's not there now. Yeah, I lost her for a pancreatic cancer. Yeah. So those 30 years, this lady has taken up the job of supporting me unconditionally.
Wow.
Believing me without any worries. And for 30 years, for my wife, I am the only old. She didn't have an old of her own.
You know, looking at some of your Twitter feeds and the love you had for her, I sometimes believe that for you, Thyrocare is like, I'm again giving an example, like Taj Mahal for your wife. So I think what you're building is literally the today's...
Let me put it this way. For the child Thyrocare, most brilliant child, I only gave the sperms. She was the mother. So her role and a contribution in this Thyrocare journey has been huge. I was only a front end. She was the most powerful back end lady. And in fact,
she was also handling HR and number of other
things.
She
was a chemistry graduate. And I work in the night, she worked in the day. That is how the laboratory become day and night working. My wife lived in the laboratory for 20 years along with my children. So that lady did not realize she needs a neighbor or she needs some social. She felt husband is everything. In fact, we wanted to have a listed company. That was a dream of me and my wife. And when I went to ring the bell in the National Stock Exchange, I was feeling very sad that I am alone. And that time, you know what my feeling was? We both were climbing Everest. And just 500 meters more, my wife left my hand and went down. And because I reached there, I went to another 500 meters and put the flag there, not with my wife. So that's the kind of emotional trauma it was. But then having said that, probably God knows what to give, what not to give, what to take out. I leave it to nature. But that she was a very powerful lady. As I said, two ladies made me very powerful. Now, coming to your question, there is a third lady who is getting ready. That's my daughter.
Ah.
And she most likely is going to be another transformer. So, she has been brought up well. My children were not extremely poor, but not rich when they were born. I was a government officer. So, my children have fundamentals in place. Even today, they use Ola. They don't have a car of their own. I don't have a house of my own even today. Are you aware?
No.
No.
You're still renting out?
Still, I live in the laboratory.
Ooh.
I can also buy a small Antilla somewhere. But my mind said, let us not splurge into show off. Mm. Let us do the core work. And I have not bought a house. By the by, the rule says, either you can buy a house or you can do a business. You can't do both successfully.
Mm.
And why did I leave my job? Because I didn't have an EMI then.
You didn't want an EMI now.
At no point of time, I feel this world is, we are only here as a, tenant. Nothing is ours.
You can't take anything anyways.
You can't take anything out. So give it back. In fact, this another philosophy. My daughter asked me very recently, Daddy, are you rich? I said, I am. What are you going to do with the money?
Mm-hmm.
Well, suddenly I thought I should be doing what Bill Gates does and what Premji does. So I told I will give it to the society. Daddy, are you not an idiot? Why? All of them loot from the society and give it to patients.
Mm.
You are looting from the patient and giving to the society. Very powerful one. My daughter was only 22 that time. I had reduced my rates some more, thinking that let me not loot.
Mm-hmm.
But fortunate in the healthcare industry, the more you reduce the rate, the more is the profit. So it all works very well. My daughter is going to do that job. She has said one thing, that what you created, I will give back by reducing the rates of the services and reaching to the needy and poor.
Wow, that's a very, very powerful statement.
So I believe my wife's role in parenting has been a very important one. Children are value-based. Children love relationships. They don't love gadgets.
Yeah.
And my daughter is looking after HR.
Hmm.
My son is looking after IT. They are fairly powerful compared to the second gens of the world.
Exactly. No, I think, especially in today's generation, the one of the fears we all have is, for parents who are already reached a status, like you said, that you don't have poor kids. Like I keep telling my son, my son wants to buy an iPhone X and I use a Xiaomi phone of 12,000 and he wants to buy a 70,000 phone. And I told him, son, because I was a son of a poor father, you are a son of a rich father. So you can talk about it. But this is the challenge today.
I think my sons have not taken my children have not taken anything more than 10,000.
Wow.
If I give them a cash 10,000, after 20 days, if I ask, they will tell, Daddy, still 2,500 are there. I ask them, what did you do? Some KFC buckets, couple of them.
Mm-hmm.
And then some mix burgers. Absolutely frugal children. I think the children should know the value of money.
Exactly.
If your children, if you have taught frugality, they will never suffer in life.
Mm.
And this is what my art of parenting education is. Don't teach children how to take EMI and suffer. Heaven on this earth is clutter-free brain, fear-free mind, EMI-free life.
Hmm.
If this is taught to the children, children will be most powerful.
And now everything they are saying, even do shopping, online shopping with EMI. Forget about buying houses. People are buying phones on EMI.
So we must educate children that it is 1 rupee means what? Even today, if I get into a 5-star hotel, if I have to take a lunch there, I will know some of my employees have to work 15 days in a month
to earn
that 5,000 or 4,000, which I'm going to splurge in next half an hour.
Wow.
This is very important.
Wow.
I have still not traveled in club class. I'm still not done any kind of spending. In fact, another way of telling is, if you create, you shouldn't consume, because consumers cannot create. Punchline.
Wow.
If you create, you should not consume, because consumers cannot create.
Exactly.
You know,
the same thing with Steve Jobs, right? He had the most minimalistic life. I mean, if you went to his house apparently had just one little, like there was no furniture, nothing, and he used to sit on the floor while he was selling the most expensive gadgets to the people. I doubt, and the joke was he didn't have his own kids use the iPhone for the longest time.
Many people ask me, sir, you were very simple. Can you explain why you remain so? I tell them, look, guy, honey and money sound similar. Honey is collected by honeybee. Money is collected by moneybee. If honeybee falls in honey, it dies. If moneybee falls in money, it will die.
Exactly.
So,
collection of money and spending of money are two different
things. Beware. Don't become the consumer.
The Vishal Gondal Show will be right back after this break.
Did you know that Parsis in Mumbai, instead of being left at the Tower of Silence after they die, are now cremated? And why? Because a cow fell sick in the early 1990s. Did you know that the smog in Delhi is caused by something that farmers in Punjab do and that there's no way to stop them? Did you know that there wasn't one gas tragedy in Bhopal, but three? One of them was seen, but two were unseen. Did you know that many well-intentioned government policies hurt the people they're supposed to help? Why was demonetization a bad idea? How should GST have been implemented? Why are all our politicians so corrupt when not all of them are bad people? I'm Amit Verma, and in my weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen, I take a shot at answering all these questions and many more. I aim to go beyond the seen and show you the unseen effects of public policy and private action. I speak to experts on economics, political philosophy, cognitive neuroscience, and constitutional law so that the insights can blow not only my mind, but also yours. The Seen and the Unseen releases every Monday. So do check out the archives and follow the show at seenunseen.in. You can also subscribe to The Seen and the Unseen on whatever podcast app you happen to prefer.
So, sir, let's say Modi ji calls you and says, we want to make you the health minister of India, given all the stuff you have. What will be your 10-point or 5-point agenda to change the face of healthcare in this country?
First, Modi should have 5 more years if I have to take up that post.
So let's assume that we gave him 5 more years.
Right. So if I am getting there, what I will do, the first thing is, if in 1960s, 70s itself, Rajkot to Trivandrum second AC ticket has been published, why not an 1.5 Tesla MRI cost is not standardized in this country? So first thing I will do is first standardize the pricing for the medical services across the country, at least diagnostic, if not for surgery.
They are at least trying to do that with stents. They did something, yes, right?
On that. Point number two. Everywhere, every infrastructure is there. All infrastructure is standing. Nothing is running. What has gone wrong in this industry, healthcare industry, is pricing. Every rich man starts business and he thinks every consumer is a rich man. So he has priced it obnoxiously high.
Yeah, the MRIs are like 5,000 and 10,000 rupees.
Absolutely.
I don't know why.
MRI should not cost 2,999.
Wow.
PET CT is 1,999. And PET CT is 6,999 is what my dream is. But having said that, I won't accept that post. Because the country is too vast.
No.
You will be defeated by the country's size and its complexity. But you have asked me a question.
If anybody can do it, it's you. I mean, I'm confident, right? If you could take a disease like Thyrocare and on your own, with your own resources, transform that one industry, I mean, I think the next role for you has to be at the governmental level.
Vishal, I have traveled in the pyramid of economy of 10 slices. From bottommost slice, and I have come to the topmost slice. I know the bottom 5 slices, what they can afford and what they need. I will provide that.
No, but you know, just think about it, right? So Nandan Nilekani came out of Infosys and was able to build Aadhaar. And you know, given all the challenges and all that, but let's say that at least Aadhaar has been a good thing. There are some challenges around it. So I'm saying, if somebody has to come from healthcare, I think the person with scale is you, because hospitals, there are like 10, 20,
it can be done.
You know. So at scale, because a country like India needs that scale.
All solutions cannot be provided, but majority of the solutions can be standardized and made to reach to the poor and needy possible.
Wow. So I think it's going to be quite interesting to see your next phase. Maybe after this,
yeah, I think
when your daughter takes over.
I must tell you, many people ask me a question, what next? So I keep telling, first 20 years I was a farmer. Next 20 years I was a scientist. Another 20 years I was an entrepreneur. Then now next option is either become a comedian or become a politician. In either way, people will anyhow enjoy.
Movie star is also one other thing.
Well, for that I am too old to be a hero. But then if you look at Bomman Irani came very late.
Yes.
I can still be. That's why I tell comedian.
Yeah.
It could be in movies also.
Wow. No, but I think, you know, politics is something, sir, you should really, really consider, especially given the challenges of healthcare which our country is facing. And only with somebody with your experience and looking at the grassroots, right? You have come right now, as you rightly said, from the bottom of the pyramid yourself.
I must tell you, Vishal, for the last 20 years, what I have done is the job of a health minister only. Affordable rates, available across the country, uniform quality, I have done for laboratory tests. So if you ask me, a percentage of the job I have already done without assuming any chair and without getting any funds or guidance from anyone else as a single individual. I'm going to do it in radiology in another 3-4 years.
Wow.
I think pathology and radiology, if you have done, I've done to the needs of the country. For that, I don't truly need to become any minister. Okay. It's a sheer logistics, HR and IT. For which I have been already having and raising a team.
Amazing.
And today I have 1,200 employees. If I can make 1.2 lakh employees, country has transformed.
Wow. Well, that's the way to do this. That's
Vision. Don't right? need the any chair thrill, or anything.
The next thrill is that, you know, I don't need to be the government. I can transform the way it is. I can be the change.
Absolutely.
And that's what Jio did to an extent, right? I mean, Jio transformed telecom. And transform the internet and transform all these spaces without being in the government.
I think somebody who can think for long term, thinking for an impact, can change this country's many spaces which are at present abused.
Yeah.
Many spaces.
So, sir, one thing I want to also quickly talk to you about, and I know you've gone through this, the word cancer. Right now, you know, we are hearing so many people suffering from this terrible condition. You know, a lot of people, we just saw one of the leading actresses just tweeted that she is getting treated. Irfan Khan, another actor. And again, in so many people we know in our circle today. And you, of course, lost your wife to cancer. So what do you think is happening? You know, is there anything around cancer? Is anything can be done? Are you thinking about from a medical perspective, from a testing perspective, anything can be done for that?
I think India as a country
is becoming an epidemic.
Is spending very little on diagnostics. If in the Western world they spend $100 per man per year, India we are spending only $4 per man per year. We don't screen. So if there are periodic annual screenings for the most frequent cancers, you could not stop it. You could have identified a bit early and prolonged the life a little longer. Let me tell you, cancer cannot be conquered.
Cannot be conquered.
People make money out of it by telling that we can conquer cancer. Only 5% out of the 95%, out of 100 are cured. Remaining 95%
are in remission.
Are
call it remission.
Dying after spending. In my own house, my father had a cancer 50 years back. And he remained hale and healthy for 50 more years.
Wow.
My wife did not remain for 50 days.
50 days?
Just 50 days it was after diagnosis. So if you look at it, when are you diagnosing and how are you treating early will prolong life and some people can escape. But 95% of the cancers are going to be truly devastating.
Wow.
And fortunately for India, India is an young country. So the incidence of cancer is not that high. In an old economy, where Japan or US or Germany, where the mean age is 45, cancer burden is 25 times higher.
No, but India is going to get there, if not now, in 10, 20, 30 years.
That is why we believe we need to do this kind of cancer diagnosis and screening in a large scale. So
are you thinking of doing anything on the cancer?
We do a PET CT as a technology. Everybody does at 25,000 rupees. Again, I am doing it at 9,999. We do have a daily around 100 people screening, scanning. But the country is still nowhere
exactly
that it should be.
So cancer is becoming a big challenge, and I think something needs to be done on the diagnostics.
We talk about cancer only when cinema stars and politicians get cancer. That is unfortunate. That is what my thought was today morning when I read the newspaper and an actress got it. Mind you, in a day, not less than 200, 300 people are dying because of cancer.
Yeah, Tata Memorial is filled. Yeah,
that itself says daily on an average 5 bodies go out in one hospital. To that extent, it is devastating. But I was connected with cancer from last 35, 40 years because I was in Tata Memorial Hospital. I know this is something which just human cannot, allopathy could not cure it. That is where allopathy failed. But having said that, treatment is possible in good number of cases if diagnosed early.
Wow. So what is your view on all these new startups which are coming in the diagnostic space? Of course, there is a very infamous startup, Theranos, which now has gone bankrupt and the CEO is going in jail. Recently, I met a very interesting company called SickTuple. I don't know if you've heard of SickTuple. So they are doing imaging via camera. So the way they do testing is that they take a blood sample and take very high resolution photos, and then they are doing AI and stuff, and that's how they are generating reports. And they are now a Bangalore, very interesting Bangalore company. They are applying for FDA approval and stuff like that. So what is, are you seeing any innovation happening around the diagnostic space?
1,000 are in, and all of them say that they are going to impact the entire medical industry. I think only 100 will remain after 10 years. And in this 100, only 10 will cross another 10 years.
Wow.
And very little, one or two can not impact completely, very little. Having said that, with such a complex body, chemistry, you know, entire physiology, it is not a car, it is not a gadget which you can identify and solve very often. God has created a wonder, and you need to first wonder how wonderful it is, and then decipher and find out what leads to what. It is going to be next thousands of years of hard work which will make men to understand truly what is going wrong with the body. Having said that, people should try, and some of them are actively trying, and finally luck should help them to package it well and deliver it well. What you do, if doesn't reach to a common man, it is not a great startup. Only when a common man utilizes, only when you bring down the cost, when make a mass consumption, it is known as an impact.
So, sir, what is your view on yoga and meditation? You know, given Coimbatore is again the house of Sri Jaggi Gurudev and, you know, the whole Isha Foundation. Did yoga or meditation influence you at all in any way?
I think yoga is helping people to keep their body flexible. And I have a reason to believe it takes out all that unnecessary consumptions you have accumulated in your body when you do yoga. Every day, even 15 minutes of yoga should be able to give somebody a good health. This is my belief. Yoga is good. You need not look at from a religious point of view, nothing. Your body needs flexing, and you need to stretch it, and that yoga helps. Meditation appears to be the disturbed mind, the one who cannot focus. I think all successful people are successful because they are focusing. And focusing itself means a meditation. So somebody who is disturbed, who has no peace of mind, needs to get into meditation. I think that is more of therapeutic. Yoga is more of creating a better physiology, better body, flexible body, and strength to body.
So, sir, what is your daily routine like? How do you keep yourself fit and healthy? How do you spend your morning, evening, afternoon?
In that way, life is not what you say, and it is not that you do what you want. You want man bahut kuch chahta hai, but then tan saath nahi deta hai. So the body is the one which refuses. Having said that, I read in the morning an hour newspaper.
One hour.
Without reading newspaper, my day doesn't start. And another 1 hour goes in getting myself ready and breakfast. And 9 o'clock itself I start. I don't travel at all because I live in the laboratory. The distance between my bedroom and boardroom is only 10 meters. This is for the last 20 years.
So the 10th floor, right? That's the 10th floor.
No, it's in 6th floor.
6th floor, sorry.
Yes.
Yeah.
So then my entire day goes in three things. Mails, files, smiles.
So
mails keep coming. I keep reading and responding. And then files keep coming. And I am very powerful in a system where filing everything is to be documented. So mails gives dynamic, fast, reach and respond. Files gives a stable, standardized system which cannot be manipulated.
Mm.
And smiles gives people to connect with you and you enjoy only smiles.
Absolutely.
So these three things are for the entire day. Some days it is all smiles and some days it is all files and some days it is more mails. But then these three are the ones which occupy me for the entire
and
day.
And how do you spend your weekends then?
Actually, we don't realize week has ended and week has started because we are living inside the laboratory. But having said that, my mails are all stopped on Sunday, so I am starved. My files don't come to my table because all employees are on weekend. And then smiles I don't get to because I don't have an old other than my employees.
Mm.
I don't attend marriages. So many people ask me a question, if you don't attend your marriages, who will attend your children's marriage? Then I tell them, look, I have got 1,200 employees. If I call all of them with family, I have 5,000 people. Why I need more people?
Mm.
So my life has been around. In fact, my HR management is very unique. I have taken 2 lunches with every employee every year.
Wow.
Right? This was my wife who started it. We had we still have that 16-seater lunch table. So she will bring 15 people.
And then have lunch.
And lunch and our dinner, our breakfast. So this has been a way. In fact, my wife has got the appreciation and love and affection of all the employees only because she was a mother for all of them.
Wow.
I will be talking, she will be feeding. So this is a very unique way of having people to trust you, to be with you. As an MD, if you sit in an air conditioned room and you don't interact with people, you will be disconnected.
Exactly.
And power of my wife. 1,200 employees were there. She knew first name of all the employees.
Wow.
Middle name for at least 400 employees.
Middle name.
And children's name at least for some 100 employees.
Man.
So that was the power of that lady. I think she had a uniqueness of loving people and being with them.
Amazing.
I think that has created the organization today what it is.
Also, do you read a lot of books? Do books come
Actually, in? I don't read books because when I read a book, I realize he's only writing what I have done. So I keep the book aside. So I couldn't complete a single book reading. I have around 50,000 books with me.
Yeah, I've seen a huge
collection. Yes, and in this I keep giving people books. So one of the ways of making people to remember you is give books.
No, and your tweets, your book of tweets
yes,
is so amazing.
I
follow you on Twitter. You are very, very amazing on that.
So 15 people who are on the lunch table, every time when they have lunch with me, they can take a book.
No, I have taken a couple of books from
so
you.
So in that too. Way, yeah. My love is buy books and give to people to read. And that continues.
And is there a particular book you give people or is it?
No, all Robin Sharma's books, all people who make people light, not get stressed.
So motivation is?
Motivation. Life is only once, gentlemen. Take care of love. Love people. The routine.
Give people positivity, right? There is enough negativity around, right? You don't need to give them more negativity.
At times, if I feel like, I want smiles. So I will tell my people, call all people who are born in July.
Mm-hmm.
So you will have a hall full of 50, 60 people, all born in July means men, women, married, unmarried, old, young, high paid, low paid, all Julys. Then another day I will call all ladies who have children.
Mm.
So that will be another set of people. This makes sure that nothing is politics there. Everybody comes, achha, you kone, ye kone. Everybody is interested only listening to me. They don't talk among themselves.
Uh-huh.
I talk for 45 minutes. I can energize people. And that is the power of my leadership in the organization.
Yes, you can energize people around you
and the
with
punchline.
Your tweets, the world.
And the punchline.
So who are your favorite actors? Because you are all about punchline. So who are your favorite
Let me finish this punchline. There are two kinds of employees. One who works for salaries, the other who works for stories.
Mm.
And if you have a good story, people will follow you. My favorite actors are Rajinikanth, Kamal Hassan, and I love Amir Khan. I love all leading actors because one or two movies, they must have touched my heart and I might have cried.
Wow.
And
so you see a lot of movies for sure.
I used to see a lot of movies till I was 25. And then I didn't see for a pretty long period because I came to Mumbai and Tamil movies were not in Mumbai.
Mm-hmm.
And then it took a pretty long period for me to understand Hindi movies. then only after 45 years of age, I started watching some of the Hindi movies. And I think for the last 10 years, I must have seen around 40 movies.
Mm. So, sir, if you were put in a room and you could only take 5 things with you. Let's say this is going to be, or let's say in a jail, like Mahatma Gandhi, and you could only take 5 things. What will be those 5 things?
A smartphone I need.
No, no, you can't take a smartphone in the jail.
No, no. Then I don't need anything. Then I don't need anything. If I happen to get into a jail, I will make sure entire jail inmates have been having a gala time and I can transform them and I can make them productive. I will make sure all IGs are met and told, you give me this, these guys all will become productive and they will make these machines or they will make these gadgets and I can transform them. I won't carry anything from outside.
Wow, that's amazing.
I must tell you, the power is I can leave home today without taking even my purse.
Wow.
So that is the power. And you know, always people tell, your wealth is what? When you lose everything and what you have.
Yes.
So jab ye bol hai, agar kahin bhi bhashan bhi diya, I get to pay 5 lakhs, 10 lakhs if I can do that. I have my comforts. And my expenditure per day is 1,000, 2,000 rupees. I'm a very frugal man.
No, absolutely.
No, as far as you are frugal, you know one thing? What is stress? Stress means kone ka dar.
Kone ka dar, yes.
Fear of losing.
Losing.
And if you, punchline, jo kona chata hai, wo kabhi kota nahi hai. Jo kone se darta hai, wo kabhi paata nahi hai.
Paata nahi hai, wow.
So kone ka dar jab nahi hota, you are the most powerful man.
Wow. When you have nothing to lose, you have everything to gain. You have everything to gain. Exactly. No, I know that's... So, I think the real secret of your success is you have somehow always got into the position that you have nothing to lose, even though you had everything. See, when you had really nothing, when in the village time, yes, you could say, I have nothing to lose. But when you were in your job at BRC, when you had started your company, when you went IPO, you know, when you, you know, lost your wife... But, you know, you are going forward because you have this magical ability to have this thing that I have nothing to lose.
Punchline here. The power of a man is his ability to press the reset button. Power of a man is his ability to press the reset button.
Keep resetting.
And how many times you press the reset button decides how far you are moving up. And many people don't dare to touch it.
Yeah, in the gaming world, we call it leveling up. You have to keep going to the next level.
So the minute you can press a reset button, you are now prepared for the next orbit. Comfort zones are danger zones.
Exactly. Exactly. No, I think, you know, these are such amazing thoughts, sir. I mean, I'm telling you that, you know, I have now got so many people on the show. But I think what we are learning from you is outstanding. I'm sure the people listening to this are going to be like jumping from their own seats, thinking of what they can do to change this. So where do you see yourself now? Like, you're still very young. 59 is, you know, you have now the next 30, 40 years to be around. And by that time, I'm sure people will find a technology to live even over 100 years. So where do you see yourself now going forward?
Yeah, for marriage, I'm too old. For a business, I'm too young. So let us look at age from that angle.
Exactly.
But I have only simple one dream. Add a zero every 6 years. So today I have 1,200 employees. My dream is 12,000 employees by another 6 years.
Wow.
So one more zero in another 6 years. So if you look at it, for the last 30 years, I have added 5 zeros.
Well,
so it is a man who is only focused on zeros. And the punchline here is, there are only two kinds of people. One who chased zeros and become heroes. Other one just didn't know what is zero.
Yeah, and they started to be a hero and they became zero. No, I mean, it is amazing. The way you are looking at this world is very, very differently. So I think the key takeaways which I am really getting here
is the ability to reset, is the ability to get to a situation where you're taking risks.
The ability to focus.
An ability to focus.
If a man can focus, he can create a hole in a hill. That is the power of focus. I am a man who can focus and achieve anything.
Wow.
A Madrasi learning Hindi, Marathi, Gujarati. A mathematician learning microbiology and physiology and endocrinology. All would have been impossible could I not have focused.
Mm-hmm.
So ability to focus
makes
you very powerful.
Wow.
The children should be taught how to focus.
Yes. Absolutely.
In my organization, the guys who focus reach to the top. The guys who are unable to focus remain in the middle and at the bottom. So this is happening in the world also.
Absolutely. So if you had a magic wand and you could go in the past or the future with the time machine, what would you change? Is there anything you would change?
Not the village, not the parents, not the poverty, not the municipal school, not the origin hostel, not the college which I studied, not the unemployment when I underthrew, not that Jayanti Janta Express, not that VT railway station, not that Baba Atomic Research Center, not that wife, not that IPO, because all the last 2-3 would have not happened had I not had the past.
Oh.
No regrets. All I enjoyed.
Exactly. Any one thing could have changed and you would have probably not been here. Wow, that's a very, very powerful thought.
Many people tell, kaas mera dhanwan hota, had I had a great father, had I get a great boss, had I get a great wife, everything people will tell, in spite of they being great, only because they couldn't use it.
Yes.
And I got everything, world. Wonderful.
So what is the last thing you purchased for yourself?
Yeah, I didn't purchase it for myself. My children have purchased it for me. One, what you call as Innova Cresta.
Oh.
Because earlier car was purchased 12 years back and they were wanting me to change. I didn't change. So one fine day when I went, there was a car standing. So I believe that is the last purchase. I didn't purchase anything in this last 20 years.
Wow.
Even all my garments, everything was purchased by my wife.
Wow.
And mind you, I never had a passbook. Never had a password, never had a lock.
Wow.
Life has become very powerful.
You had nothing to store.
Nothing to store. So my wife took care of me. Now my children are taking care of me. They recently got me one iPhone telling that, Daddy, you are using mails too much.
Mm-hmm.
And mail is very good in iPhone, so you must have.
Mm-hmm.
And then this one was the last purchased one.
The Modi jacket.
Yeah, which was around 3,000 rupees. I was reluctant to buy. And my son told, okay, you don't buy. Then we came home. The next day he went and purchased it. Because we have a very unique system at my home. If anything to be bought, all three of us have to agree.
Oh.
So we don't spend.
All three of you have to agree. Wow.
But if you ask me what recent things I have purchased, a cyclotron for $3 million. And PET CT machine, each is $1 million. I have purchased 12 of them. And let me tell you here, there are two things for which you cut a check. One is for expenditure, another is for investment.
Mm.
If it comes to expenditure, I don't sign. When it comes to investment, I don't even see, even if it is 100 crore, I sign. People have to differentiate. Investments are different. Expenditures are different.
Investments are all about the future. Wow, such a powerful thought.
Yeah, I have some more punchlines. I tell people, love music, not food.
Mm. So you are big into music yourself?
I enjoy music. So love music, not food. Love nature, not gadgets. Because I love a drive to Lonavala.
And from your place, it is faster to go to Lonavala than come to Andheri.
And the third one is, burn calories, not salaries. So people are burning salaries, not calories.
Wow.
So
everybody is burning salary, you are right. Well, this is the difference between you and the others. You are worth a few thousand crores, who is wanting to burn calorie, and the people who are earning the salary are cribbing about why they are not doing well, why is their boss not good, why is this person bad. Like, you know, it's so amazing, right? So like, we have this awesome
healthy lunch coming into our office and we were giving it to employees. And people are complaining about that, oh, it's too bland and it's too this and it's too... I'm like, listen, we are giving you lunch on the house and people are complaining that, oh, it is not as tasty as they want it to be. And the problem is that, you know, there's always better things in life, but you need to go and choose.
Let me tell you, there is a song of MGR in 1960s. The song says, by default, all children by birth are creators. By default, all children by birth are creators. If they become consumers, it is because of parents, grandparents and servants. So it is important, upbringing of the child should be appropriate. And something goes wrong, that is why we have today negative thinking, negative approach. And when I meet my staff for the first time, I start with Tuch Tuja Jeevanacha Silpakar Ahe.
Are wa, Marathi also.
Vaman Rao Pai said it.
Yeah.
You are the sculptor
of your own life.
Don't blame someone else.
Exactly. People blame circumstances, people blame... So I keep saying this. So my favorite quote is that destiny is not a matter of chance, it's a matter of choice.
Absolutely, you can choose it.
Yeah, you can choose it by deciding and you can't... You can keep blaming circumstances, you can blame karna hai to hajar cheeze hai. You know, agar kuch karna hai to you just need one reason to do it. And there are a million reasons not to do it. You decide what you want to focus on.
Absolutely, blaming is only to tell that it is not mera kasur.
Hmm.
Actually, it is your kasur.
So finally, sir, how do you want to be remembered as? What is the legacy you think you are creating?
By year 2100, in some textbooks of medical technologies, they should read, Dr. Velumani was the man who came in and he made sure volume benefits have been achieved by mass processing of laboratory testing, and then he has changed the cost effectiveness of diagnostic tests in the country, if possible in the world.
I have to tell you that I have asked this question to many people. Nobody could answer it with that clarity. I think the most amazing thing, sir, here is the clarity at which you are thinking. Your clarity of how you want to be remembered. All I can tell you, sir, that I am going to remember you for my entire life.
Thank you very much.
And, you know, it has been... Every time I meet you, I get charged, I get energized, and I know why. Because of your positivity, your never-say-die attitude and your ability to reset. So we are going to get you back here, by the way, given that you're going to do so many more things.
Thank you.
It has been an absolute pleasure to have you on the show, sir.
I too enjoyed, Vishal, and it was also for me a wonderful, enjoyable evening.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir.
Hello there, my name is Naveen Narona, and as a gay person in India, I get asked a lot of stupid questions.
Beta, is it LGBT or eligibility?
How do two men procreate?
Bro, is Grindr better than Tinder or what?
We answer all these questions and much more on my podcast, Keeping It Queer, where I talk to individuals from the LGBT community in India and learn about their personal stories. Catch all the episodes on the IVM podcast app or any other podcasting app you like. Till then, keep it queer.
A show where three people come together to tell you about stuff they like. A movie, a TV show, a book, and other stuff. Tune in every Monday on the IVM podcast app to IVM Likes. Batman approves this message. Thank you, Batman.